Appreciate this opportunity. And, you know, with the marvels of modern technology, I'll start by saying I'm away on vacation this week in the beautiful island of Mesquite down off the coast of Venezuela. And here I am on a cell phone and a wireless connection, able to give a presentation. It just tells us how far we've come in the last several years of technology. But and thank you for all those great accolades. But, of course, there's none that I'm happier of than to say that I'm the proud parent of a Hoya. With, and Sarah pointed out, my daughter graduating just this past spring. So that was a wonderful 4 years of our life as a family, and we're very, very pleased and excited about that. I've also had the chance over the last couple of years as well to get to know many aspects of Georgetown that have been pretty exciting to me, and in particular, Georgetown Scholarship Program is something that I've seen. I'm going to talk about that a little later in the presentation, which is just an amazing opportunity for young men and women from around the world to that really don't have the means to attend a great university that you have all seen and where they can participate. So it's quite a program run by some very special people, and hoping to do a lot with that, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. So I'm going to talk about venture capital for a little bit. I'll give a little bit of a plug about Highland and who we are, and then talk about mistakes that we often see with companies just getting off the ground. And I'll look at these mistakes maybe as a lesson in terms of what we can all think about as we look at starting businesses or becoming part of young startups, a good way to take it through. So, Highland Capital, we were formed in 1988, which makes us one of the granddaddies of venture capital. The firm's been around now for just about 25 years. That's a long time as far as the industry is concerned. The industry hasn't been around for all that many years. Today, we have, in total, $3 billion under management. That's over the course of 8 funds. We've backed over 200 companies in a lifetime. We have a very diversified strategy, and by that I mean we back companies that both seed, which means just raw startup, early stage, and growth. What we are distinctly not, and I'll talk about this later, we're distinctly not a buyout firm of any type. So we're all about backing young companies and looking to grow. Our business today is all focused on either enterprise technology or consumer technology. There was a period in our life when we made a number of healthcare investments, but we focused more narrowly today. And we have 20 individuals that are responsible for making the investments themselves in offices in Boston, Silicon Valley, Geneva, London, and Shanghai, and then a support staff that's much larger as well. My own background is I'm a graduate of Northeastern University up in Boston, and that's really where my tech career began. I was about as far from a technology, as you can ever imagine. I was a business major at Northeastern, and I had a co-op assignment. And those that aren't familiar with cooperative education, it's a program where you, in the time, at least in the era I attended, it was for a lot of kids that couldn't afford to do otherwise, but you'd go to school for 6 months, you'd work for a company for 6 months, you'd go to school for 3 months, you'd work for 3 months. And I was lucky enough to land a job at IBM in their sales division as a college student, essentially as an intern. And that led me into a career in technology. Sorry about these little things that are popping up. I couldn't get out of the mouth of that. I ended up, anyhow, working at IBM. I came out. I worked for some tech companies over the years. And then in 1995, which is an eternity ago now, I started a company called Alikos. It was developed by some computer scientists down at Carnegie Mellon University. When I say it, meaning the software was developed. The person that invented the software, though, did not want to be part of a business, wasn't interested in working in a company in any way. He was a dedicated and very capable, tremendously capable university researcher, and he was looking to sell his software. Now, at the time, there was no company of any that existed around this. It was just raw. It was just raw software that existed. We built the business around that. I came on as the first employee of the company with about $2 million in venture capital backing and built the business from there. I took it public, as was told, 9 months after inception and had a very good run as a public company. We exceeded Wall Street estimates for 22 consecutive quarters. And then, as was pointed out, we sold the company in 2001 for the very end of 2000 for a little under $6 billion. So it was a great transaction at all levels. It was a great company. It was a wonderful ride. I then joined Highland Capital On the very day that I resigned from Terra Lycos, after selling the company, I stayed as the CEO of the combined company for a few months and decided that I wanted to try something different with my life. I resigned from Terra Lycos and joined Highland Capital that day as an investment professional, and that's where I work today. So enough of the background, and we'll get right into the meat of this and talk about a little bit about where we are and what we do. And some of this will blend together. I'll be talking about what we do at Highland, but I'll be using that to as a basis of a way to think about companies and as you go up there thinking about things. For starters, we back entrepreneurs with really oversized ambitions. The listed here on the page are just four of the companies that we back recently. Lululemon Athletica, which is the women's yoga wear, a company called Vistaprint, which is online printing and stationery and business cards, and a couple of hardcore tech companies, one that became the basis of everything around advertising on the iPhone or the iPad. And the point here is that we're looking for markets that have the capability to be enormous. It's great to have a business idea that says that I can capture 100% market share, but if the market is small, and will always stay small, it doesn't become very exciting, and it's hard to build a company of significance, a company of distinction. So we focus on what we believe are going to be very oversized markets. We look at entrepreneurs of any age. There's no right time to start a company. I was 38 years old when I started Lycos. If I look back with any regret, I wish I had done my own company sooner. I always had what I feel was an entrepreneurial ambition, but I was just really too slow to get myself started, and I wish I had done it a lot sooner. The young man that's shown on this page started this company, which is amazing. The company is called Scavenger, but it's a set of online payment tools or mobile payment tools that let you pay for your products or services across several thousand merchants in the United States and growing very rapidly every single day. He was a freshman at Princeton at the time that he started it. He dropped out of Princeton, much to his parents' chagrin, started his company, which is now a business with a national acclaim and growing rapidly, and probably one of the hottest companies in the mobile space. At the same time, we backed folks that had been around the block many, many times in terms of businesses. So I think it's a fallacy to say you need to be young, and it's a fallacy to say you need to be old. There's no right age. What there is to say you have the ambition and the drive to put something together. And speaking of drive, that's an important criteria when we think about a company and we're ready to get something launched and something started. A business here is called Genvara. They are online jewelry, is what they provide. And what this person was looking to do is disrupt an industry that hadn't seen innovation in, you know, probably forever. I mean, jewelry is one of the oldest industries around, been around for thousands of years, and seen very little innovation. And this guy came along and said, I want to change it. And he allows every piece of jewelry sold and purchased to be customized, which means rather than walking into the jeweler and saying, here's what I have, the jeweler says, here's what I have on the shelf, you go to the genvara.com website and you literally design a piece that is around your own needs, and you change the metal type or the stone type or the settings and size and any number of variables, and it's a nice online business. And then, of course, we back smart entrepreneurs. It's very important to us that folks have done their homework and have done their research and looked deeply into a business. These are a couple of Harvard Business School graduates that formed a business called Rent the Runway. And what they do is they take designer fashion wear, and instead of selling it to you, they rent it. It's a business out of New York that distributes product nationally with great success, but really, really smart folks that said, let me again change or disrupt an industry that hadn't seen a lot of innovation. If I was looking for a great piece of clothing, my option was very simple, which I'd have to go out and buy it, and often at a cost of a lot of money, and especially to a young person looking for that clothing, it's unaffordable. This company takes top designer brands and makes them all available for rental. The designers love it, the customers love it, it's a great consumer experience, and it works across the board. We love early stage in terms of investments. This is a company that we incubated, just working in their little startup space that we had out of a Highland office, an incubation space, and the entrepreneur painted our wall one night that success equals profits was his message to this company that we needed to start driving the bottom line, and well, it's what we love. I mean, you see the nice tight cramped quarters, but it's a classic picture of what a startup is all about, with folks just working hard across the board. Although we're not committed to only early stage, as I said earlier, we'll back something that's a growth stage. A company is looking for, it's been around for a good amount of time, and is looking for growth capital to build a business. Typically, however, where you'd find Highland Capital involved is the first institutional capital, which means someone may have raised some money from friends and family or from seed investors or angel investors, but usually not another venture capitalist that we're going to be involved. We pride ourselves on that. We have an entrepreneurial center that we have, and the companies listed on this page have all started in our offices. We have a great incubation facility where we provide mentorship and sponsorship for companies that are trying to get off the ground, and these are just some of the teams that have been involved and that have launched within our facilities. And we find that's really important, because the life of an entrepreneur is often a lonely life. It's surely one of challenges and setbacks, disappointments, failures, and there's a lot that goes on there. And trying to do that by yourself is a tough thing. And what we really try to do is encourage our entrepreneurs to know each other and to work with each other and to be aware of each other, so they can share that rough road. And of course, that rough road is there often, but the success and the thrill of victory that an entrepreneur feels when the company is finally succeeding and you finally see it start to gather momentum, it's just very, very powerful. We build relationships very, very early with companies. We have a program, and I'll mention this just briefly in the event there's any students online. We have a program that we call Summer at Highland, and it's a pretty simple little program. It's a no strings attached. We provide a small stipend for about 10 weeks of work to teams from anywhere from 2 to 5 individuals that are looking to start a company. We provide that $18,000. They provide a facility to work in, either at our Cambridge, Mass office or our Menlo Park office out in San Diego Road. And we provide some great mentors across the board from places like Google and Amazon and Airbnb and Kayak and many, many others. And we take
We might have lost you there for a second. Sorry, everyone. Bob will be dialing back in. As he did mention, he is on a small island right now, but he will be getting back on the line in just one moment. I apologize for this inconvenience. Bob, do we have you back on the line?
Sorry. We have. All right. So all that great speech I gave about modern technology, and it just didn't want to cooperate, did it? Of course, there goes the phone. But anyhow, I'm back, and in 1 second we'll have the things ready to go. Okay. So the hopefully that doesn't happen to us again, but I can't make any promises. Anyway, so the Summer at Highland program, the intention behind that is looking to develop relationships early with folks that at some point in their career might want to be part of a startup, and it's generally aimed at young students that are in place with it. And, okay, just bear with me for 1 second, because if we've logged out, there's some other. Okay, if you're not starting a company, it's not necessary that everyone has that flash of brilliance that says, here's my idea. We have active in our portfolio today probably close to 100 businesses, and I would say of those 100, there's probably 80 of those are hiring people, maybe 90 of those are hiring people right now, because they're all in some type of growth mode. We have at our website, which is hcp.com, what we call the Highland Career Network, and there are always jobs listed there, and there's typically dozens, in some cases hundreds of jobs that are listed and available in our companies that are spread all across the world. So I'm going to talk now for a couple of minutes about what we see in terms of the mistakes that we find that entrepreneurs stumble across as they're just getting businesses off the ground. And some of these mistakes relate to how you raise money. Some relate to the work you're doing behind the business to get it going. Some relate to how you think about your company. And of course, there's no perfect way to do this. It's being an entrepreneur and developing a company is much important fundamental rules of the very important as we start to think about a company. And you take the other side of these mistakes that we see often, and you'll see that they're what you can learn from these in terms of you start to get something off the ground. And the hope here is that we have a little less of failing and a little more of great big success stories. So number one, didn't research and don't understand the competition. This we see time and time and time again as people will come into our offices with an idea. They understand product that they're looking to serve or the market that's exciting to them, but really with not a deep enough understanding as to who else is doing it, whatever it may be. Who else is looking to attack the same territory that you are? And there are many places where that's important. There are large established companies. There are raw startups that are operating still in stealth mode, and there are all the companies in between that have launched. And the question for you would be, how do you differentiate yourself in what is inevitably a crowded field? This is especially so today because it's the rare company that we come across, the very rare company that we come across that is able to have a free reign for any sustainable period of time. It's unusual to have an idea work that doesn't get followed by with fast followers of all sorts of copycats that look to do the same thing. So the question is, what can you as an entrepreneur do to, one, establish barriers to entry, and two, not find yourself as that follower that just can't catch up with someone that's run ahead, someone that was there before you, and how can you avoid putting a lot of effort and a lot of money into a business that is just a very, very crowded field. Number two, and this is an amazing one and we see a lot, and it's you haven't talked to the customers, which means there's a group of folks that work and do a great job of planning a business and thinking about a business and thinking about ideas that they might have for getting something off the ground and all the basic necessities to say, boy, I have something pretty exciting and pretty powerful, and I know if I build it, they will come. But the only thing we fail to do is we haven't asked anybody if they will come. We haven't done what is the most fundamental level of research in getting a company off the ground, is talking to those people that are eventually going to become your source of revenue, your source of vitality, your source of purpose, to say, do they really care about the product? Now, some people can get away with this. Steve Jobs used to be proud of saying, I don't ask my customers what they want because they don't know what they want. And he got away with that for a long time. But and even if someone is as smart as Steve Jobs, didn't always have it right, but that's the rare individual. And it's just such a tough thing to do with any consistency over time if you're not out in the marketplace talking. So one of the things that we look at really really early in our dialogue with a potential company that we will back is who have you talked to? Tell us about the research that you've done with customers in your particular field. Tell us about the focus groups or the people they've had, and show us the notes that you've taken. And it becomes pretty strong. I had a woman just this week send me a video of some extensive, and she's looking for funding for a young company, a video of some extensive user testing that they had performed. And the thing that I was impressed about here is the user testing that she showed didn't show everything all rosy. It laid out a lot of challenges the company had with its core product. Now, that wasn't troubling to me at all. Actually, that showed to me an entrepreneur that had a lot of insight and really wanted to take the time to understand what the marketplace was saying. The things that were wrong with the product were easily fixable, but it was a person that was hearing from the marketplace and was learning, I think, quite readily what might work, and it worked out quite well. So it's a question of really getting out there and talking to the customer. This is kind of a little aside to the basic point here, but when somebody is thinking about how they're going to provide sustainable customer differentiation over time, which says not only do I understand the product that I'm building, but how will I keep my customers happy? What is it that I'm going to do that will make me a landmark in the marketplace for great customer service? And how do I stand out? You know, I like to tell a story. This is an old one. It goes back a long time to when my oldest son was a couple of years old. My wife and I took him down to Walt Disney World. And we went down to the theme park and stayed in one of the Walt Disney World resorts. And he had this little stuffed animal that he carried everywhere he went. It was attached to his hip. And he called his little stuffed animal Puffy. Well, lo and behold, we convinced my son Brian to leave Puffy in the room if we went off to the theme park for the day. It was one of the rare occasions that he left Puffy behind. And as luck would have it, we came back to the hotel and Puffy was gone. There was no sign of Puffy to be had. And it was havoc in the Davis household. My son was in tears. It was what had happened to this great treasure of his. We couldn't find it. We called down to the front desk, and they said, "We're sorry. We'll look for it." And about 5 minutes later, someone knocked at the door of our hotel room from Disney, and there was a customer service representative standing there handing us a Disney stuffed animal. They were giving us a Tigger. And they said, "Here you go, because you've lost yours, we have this for you." And, of course, my son was in hysterics because, as we all know, there's no way Tigger can replace a Puffy. And lo and behold, he stayed in his tears. And Disney then marshaled what seemed like that entire company. They were calling us every half hour with an update. They had people looking for it. We had the hotel manager reaching out to us. And I was one person that was staying in that park for a couple of nights. And at that stage in my life, barely had two nickels to rub together. And about 4 hours later, there was the call we got. The hotel manager had called to our room and said that they found this stuffed animal in the laundry facility. When they had made up the room, he got wrapped up with it. It was in the laundry facility, and they were bringing him back. It would take another hour or so, and then he came back, and there it was. And my son was happy, and it was a great day. And to boot, they gave him the Tigger as well, so we had a couple of animals. But the point that I'm making is that was a moment of truth. Here I am almost 25 years later telling that story with Disney as a customer service icon, because they took something that went wrong and they turned that into such a positive that I, for one person, became a lifelong and loyal fan of that organization. And we're always faced with these moments of truth in our business and in our interaction that we have each and every day. It's these unique times that we can use to differentiate our company, ourselves, our services into the marketplace. And I encourage anyone to be looking for those each and every day. It's not always about starting a company either when you find these moments of truth. It's how do we interact with each other on a day-to-day basis? How do I work in my existing organization to show my boss that there's really something special that I can do? And when I see that breakout moment, I capture it, and I reach for it, and I do it. And boy, what a difference it makes in terms of the way people view us and the way people think about us. Okay, moving on. Number three, in terms of issues, it's no repeatable customer acquisition strategy. So I can always get a customer once. I can build anything and get a customer once. But the idea to find an affordable and repeatable method of bringing customers back to my company is a lot harder than it sounds. And you want to be careful that you don't lull yourself into a sense of security that says, I can capture, because I captured one customer, that I can do that again and again. Now, if I want to go off and spend $100,000 marketing to acquire one customer that's going to spend $100 on my website, well, that's an easy thing to do, and I guarantee I can do it, but I'm not going to ever make any money doing that. So in the online world that is so competitive, it's how do I find a way where customers want to come to me in a repeatable fashion? How do I find a way that customers will utilize my product and people will know about it? Now, a lot of technology companies, especially in the consumer-facing world, think, well, I'll just go advertise on Google or on Yahoo or Microsoft, and I'll find my customers that way. That works for a little bit, but it's tough to have that be long-term, sustainable, or affordable. So developing that repeatable strategy is very important, and it's one of the things that we look for in any level of presentation. At the early mid-stage or growth stage company, it's critically important to us to get an understanding of that and get a flavor for how that comes together. Sometimes entrepreneurs don't tell a good story. They come in really not prepared with the full version of stuff. They're doing a little bit of copycat work from what others have said in the past, and they fail. They might have a great business, but they fail to encapsulate that in a way that others can understand it effectively. We call it the elevator pitch, and it's the ability to have that from that first floor to the 16th floor when you're riding with someone, the ability to say, here's what I'm doing and here's why it's exciting. And if you can get that elevator pitch down really quick, you can tell your neighbor, your friend, your grandmother what your business is about and have in a minute or two get them excited, it's probably a pretty good bet that you can tell the rest of it. And that's what we look for. We don't look, by the way, this is a surprise to many, we don't look for business plans. I don't think I've read a business plan in 15 years. I look for detailed PowerPoint presentations that lay out the aspects of the business, but I don't look for a lot of prose and a lot of text to tell me what a company is going to do. I can understand that you see that with the plan you put together, but the actual prose and text is really not important. We look for a step-by-step thought in terms of what you've done. What I'll read in great detail are your financial projections. I want to understand that. I want to see all the things that I just talked about on acquiring customers, and I want to see all of that. But trying to write a book or a novel around a company is generally not a good use of time. Number five is we see companies come in that don't know a lot about us, which is always tricky. There's a type of investment we make, and there's a type of investment we don't make. For instance, I said we're not healthcare investors. So somebody showing up at Highland with a great healthcare idea would be probably not making very efficient use of their own time or of mine. We don't invest in, we don't do buyouts. So if you're a billion-dollar organization looking to find liquidity for the founders, we're not the organization that's going to do that. It's rare that we do late follow-on rounds where a bunch of other VCs have been there. So if you're raising your Series D round for a company that's been in existence, that's not a place for us. But each of those companies, each of those segments where I said it's not a place for us, there is an investor that is excited about that segment. And there is an investor that will do that with consistency and regularity that's focused there. So it's really understanding, if you think about investors as your market or as your customers maybe in a different way, it's to do your homework and to do your research. Here's my biggest pet peeve of all that we find is folks will make stuff up instead of saying, I don't know. There isn't a business that has all the answers, especially the type that we invest in, where companies are required to turn and pivot time and time and time again. The companies that we back, it's so unusual to have the business concept that we back be the same one that exists on a successful exit, because there's been many turns and twists along the way that are tough to predict. And to think that you come in for that early presentation or that early discussion or that early meeting with your employees, and you're trying to say that you have all the answers, it's just not ringing true. It's always okay for someone to say to me, well, you know, I don't know, that's a good question, I'll find out. Or I don't know, that's a lousy question, and here's why, it doesn't matter. But it's okay not to have the answers. And as you find the questions arising, sometimes, it's the basis of some good research to put you on a trail that says, you know what, I need to dig into that a little bit. And it becomes pretty obvious pretty quickly when someone's on a path just trying to wing it, as they say. And it's as I pointed out, the pet peeve that I have that drives me crazy when we find it, when folks are just kind of running with that classic BS factor. Okay, here's another interesting one. When folks do research, there's a tendency sometimes to seek only confirming evidence of your idea. I want to find all the folks that say I love it, but I don't want to find the folks that say I hate it. I don't want to speak to the customers that say I will never buy that. I don't want to speak to the customers that say that won't work for me. And I focus on the good news and only what I want to hear, rather than what the marketplace at large is telling me. And by the way, the reason that all of these things are so important is, as I'm going to talk about in just a minute, the odds are stacked against an entrepreneur. Most startups, unfortunately, fail. And if something's not going to work, you really want to have, or an idea is not going to fly, you want to know that early to avoid a lot of time and a lot of money. But better yet, you want to know where the pitfalls are so you can adapt and you can pivot early on, so you can improve your probability of success. So seeking that disconfirming, if there's such a word, evidence, to me, and to a great honor to Moore, is just so important. You want to find the contrarians that you can discuss it with and say why this might not be the case or why you might find challenges, and really get a good understanding of that. Okay, number 8 is pick advisors that are easily accessible but not necessarily relevant. And what that takes us back to is, around any business, there will be a cadre of individuals that are important to your organizational and product and engineering and sales development. Folks that will be able to help you, that are smart experts in the field, who will help you with your business. They may have a formal role with the company, they may be employees of the company, they may be on your board of directors, they may be casual advisors, and they could be all of the above. And what sometimes folks tend to do is they say, well, let me get somebody that, because I can get them, because I know Mr. Smith or Mrs. Jones down the street and she's available for me. But and maybe Mr. Smith is an accomplished CEO but doesn't have any relevant experience to what I'm about to start. And he may or may not be helpful to me. So think about those people that you're looking to help you with your company that have real deep relevance around the particular category you're interested in finding that support. And by the way, I say the category, it could be very narrow, it could be very broad. And that CEO down the street, that's the accomplished executive that I mentioned, may be relevant for company, because you may say, you know, I'm not looking for him to help me with a product strategy or a sales strategy. I'm looking for him to be just a good big brother that I can call on every now and then and say, hey, I'm confused as a CEO, where do I go for some help? But think about those individuals as you seek them out, and really think about the relevancy that someone might have to the problem that you're trying to solve and how they can be support of you. Number 9 is treat fundraising like it's an end, not a means. Some guys and gals, when they complete a fundraising, celebrate. Oh my gosh, isn't this great? I've just raised $8 million, as if the project is complete. Well, the business isn't about raising capital. The business is about building a company of distinction, as I mentioned earlier. And ultimately, the business is about some type of meaningful exit. And that exit could be you're running a lifestyle business where you want to see meaningful cash flow that gets distributed back to yourself and your investors. The exit might mean you want to be acquired by somebody. The exit might mean you'll be a long-term public company. It could be any of the above, but it's surely not that financing event unto itself. I want to try to be a little conscious of time, because I know I was asked to leave plenty of room for Q&A, so I'm going to try to wrap through these last couple of slides a little more quickly so I can stick on that schedule. What first-time entrepreneurs should know about venture capital? A couple of things. One is, we are just one of many, many options that exist out there. A lot of ways to raise money without looking at VCs in the mix. And for instance, non-equity based, you can bootstrap the business yourself. You can put your own sweat equity into a company. You can take out loans. You can apply for many grants that exist across the country from a number of different programs. And you'll find in these non-equity based financing, a lot of them are a great way to get started. They're an easier way to do that first 2 or 3 months of getting a company off the ground. Sometimes, by the way, someone can bootstrap a company for all of its corporate life. Sometimes somebody will take a company and say, okay, I can develop this and keep it going with my own capital, and I never need anyone else's. That's a great way to go, because you preserve all the equity for yourself. And if you have the means to do that, by all means, just stay down that path. Equity-based financing with friends and family, for sure, means who are the acquaintances that I have in the market, who are the folks that have deep enough pockets that can help me. Angels and seed firms, although Highland is listed under that, we're really not a seed financing organization. I'd put Highland great in that that venture capital area that's in that kind of bluish green shade that you see is where we really are. We do a little bit of growth equity, but there are growth equity firms and there are angel and seed firms that are focused entirely on that. And there's a whole slew of them now. In fact, every time we find a great company like a Facebook that has an IPO, they probably created 500 angel investors out of the Facebook employee base with folks that made enough money on that IPO that they're looking to go off and back the companies of others that might be launched into the marketplace. And then, of course, lastly, there are the public markets, yet another way to grab that capital that might be out there. Our business is an interesting one. This is a complex slide, but here's the net of it, is that we get paid from a really small number of home runs. The way our business works is that we will lose all our capital, generally in about 2 out of 10 deals. And when I say we, I don't mean Highland Capital. I mean the industry itself. Our numbers are proprietary, but these are national venture capital numbers. Lose 100% of your investment on 2 out of 10 investments. 5 out of 10 investments will earn somewhere less than 0.99. So we'll not get all of the capital back. The remaining 3 investments is where it all comes from. So these big hits that become worth a lot of money is how this business works in totality. So what we are thinking of all the time is people with big ideas to build companies of distinction, as I talked about earlier. The things that are important to us when we look at a transaction, number one is far and away is team. We're interested in smart, driven, hungry individuals that have an expertise in the area around the company they're looking to start. People are what make a company, always has been, always will be. People are the foundation that allow you to build a business. It's the equation that works. And that is far and away foremost to us. Two is big markets. As I talked about before, we're not interested in saying how can we become a 100% share of a marketplace that's really small. Just doesn't matter to us because that big, large exit isn't there. And we're also looking for entrepreneurs that are thinking about really big. And these numbers will sound crazy, but it's the way our business works. When an entrepreneur says that I'm starting a business with a couple $100,000 in capital and I want $1 million in capital from Highland and they have aspirations to sell their company for $50 million someday, it's just not interesting to us. We look for companies that can create new billion-dollar marketplaces, which means companies that can be very, very sizable. Now, that doesn't always happen, of course. Many along the way are sold for considerably less than that, but the aspiration needs to be there. The hope and the dream needs to be there, building a company of great distinction. Next is product and technology, and this is a surprise to many when they come into our office to pitch a deal. People will want to start with product right away and say, let me tell you about this new mousetrap that I've developed, and don't realize that it's the people in the market is where we're most focused, and then product is that very important, but that distant third down on our list. And then last is the deal. Eventually I need to get there. Eventually I need to know how much money you want and on what terms, but it's not as important or a relevant conversation at all until we can satisfy those first three. But when we finally do get to deal, we're looking for capital efficient models, which means can you develop what it is, can you bring to market what you're offering in a way it doesn't consume vast amounts of money before you can establish meaningful proof points. We love good ideas, but we prefer great execution. And it's how do you take an idea and how do you build that and how do you deliver that into the marketplace? And then we love numbers. The entrepreneurs are folks that have this obsessive paranoia about measuring everything. They look at dashboards when they wake up. They look at dashboards when they go to bed at night. They're looking at every level of that company and saying, how is it performing in a quantitative level. And as we begin to wind down, it's unfortunately, it's a lot easier to get our advice than our money. With most firms, look at hundreds of businesses to the very, very few that we end up backing. And over the course of a year, we'll back on our firm anywhere from a dozen to 25 companies over the course of a year. And that's pretty traditional for the industry itself. So very, very selective in terms of the companies that we are involved with. We're here to help. We have a number of resources that are there. We on our website, which I said is hcp.com. We have a component that is all about entrepreneurship. We have our Summer at Highland program that I talked about before. Our career opportunities are at hcp.com/careers. We're very accessible. Our email addresses are on the website. Our phone numbers are on the website. My Twitter handle is here, by the way, and I encourage you all to follow me at Bob Davis HCP. And in fact, I doubly encourage you to call me because I have this challenge with one of my partners as to which of us will have the most Twitter followers over the course of the next couple of weeks. So you can all be my assistants in that challenge that I have underway with him, a little bit of a fun bet that we have going. But as I said, we're there, and we're there with advice often. We're quite accessible across the board. Although accessibility, as I pointed out, isn't the driving criteria, it's relevancy. And there are many, many organizations and firms and companies that we would not be relevant to. So I would encourage you to reach out to us when you think there's relevancy. I talked about the GSP program as well that's at Georgetown. Some of you may be graduates from that. I don't know. It's one that is, to me, a spectacular program that is a great source of talent, and it's a great source of students for those of you that are hiring that may not have the means or connections that many of us are afforded in the way to get into businesses, and it's a great opportunity. I've just been blown away with what Georgetown has done with this program. It's been pretty powerful. If you don't know it, I encourage you to learn a little bit more about it. So with that, I thank you for your time. We're going to open this, I think, to some questions right now, and I'll turn it back to Sarah, and she'll tell me how the Q&A is going to work.
All right, great. So yes, everyone, I encourage you to submit your questions to Bob right now. Bob, thank you so much for that presentation, and I'll just give you our first question. How do you get over the fear of socializing your idea and / plan? How do you get over thinking it will result in someone taking it and running with it?
Yeah, that's a great question, and I would say it varies, but the reality of it is your idea is generally your passion, and it's tough for someone to steal your passion, and that's really what makes it work. When you start to socialize the concept that you have, you feel it, you breathe it, you believe it, you dream it, and for someone to hear one concept of it and to charge themselves up and to learn enough in a quick enough period of time is really tough to do. The reality of it is that at some point you have to expose your idea because it's called a customer launch, and at that point when you start getting customers, there will be copycats for sure. People will show up and try to do the same thing, but I think that the
Bob. No, I'm sorry, everyone. I think we just lost Bob for one more time, but he will dial back in. So I know I do see you have quite a few questions here. So don't worry, we will make sure that Bob answers them. And I will remind everyone at this time, this is being recorded. So the webinar will be on YouTube. You can find that in about a day or two. And I will send everyone a copy of Bob's slides. And then while he is dialing back in, I do want to also let you know that our next webinar in the entrepreneurship series, as I said, we're doing about one a month. So the next one is on April 2nd. And that is called Creating Something from Nothing, Developing Your First Product. And two alums, Richard Matsui and Nick Malaya, they've started their own company, KWH Analytics, and they're working with solar energy. So they'll be discussing how they did that. And then I hope that you will continue to check our webinar calendar because we'll be doing many more after that. But we're very excited for them to come speak to us. And let me one more moment here. Hopefully Bob will be hopping back on the line. All right, everyone. Hopefully Bob will join us in 1 minute, but if he does not, I know we still do have 10 more minutes left on the webinar. If he is unable to join, I will make sure he receives your questions. And I'll make sure we get an email address for him so that you can personally chat with him after the webinar. And for a few of you have questions about the April 2nd webinar, you can go on our Facebook page. If you go to Facebook and search Georgetown University Alumni Career Services, just like us, and then you can see all of our upcoming events, and really all of our events are the webinars. So you can browse our webinars through there, or you can visit alumni.georgetown.edu. Go to the Career Services tab, and then look it through our webinars and events section. And from there, you'll also see our webinar archive so that you can look at past webinars. But from there, you can just click on the title and register on GoToMeeting for all the upcoming sessions. All right, and I am going to, we have a comment from one alum on the line while we wait for Bob. Marketing, Advertising, and PR Week is going on right now in the Career Education Center. So if you are in one of those industries and are interested in going to speak to students or sitting in on any of the workshops just as an alum, then definitely go on the Career Center website, careerweb.georgetown.edu. I know Google was on campus yesterday, which was pretty exciting. Okay, it looks like, sorry, I just got a message from Bob. His phone is not cooperating. I'm so sorry. We typically do not have, we typically do not experience technical difficulties. And to those of you who are still asking, yes, I will email PowerPoint slides to everyone, and the session was recorded. If everyone could just email me their questions.
Hello, guys. Sorry about that. Finally back.
Perfect. That's great.
Yeah, we ended up with a, I had to finally give up on the phone we had and race on another cell phone. This is, I take back everything I said about the marvels of modern technology. So here we are.
Anyhow, that
last question, I think I just wrapped up, and I would say be brave and courageous, and I don't think you really have to worry about people stealing your ideas. Surely from a venture industry, as I talked about with us, we don't back ideas, we back people first, and we don't go off and start businesses. We look for people to do that. So I would encourage you to have the courage to go off and put your idea into the marketplace. I think when you have that paranoia about it, it's probably unnecessary.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you, Bob. Our next question, what are your thoughts on NDAs? Are they not worth the time?
No, an NDA can be helpful. Depends what you're trying to put into place. Non-disclosure agreement is what an NDA refers to, if those of you aren't familiar, because an NDA can cover things such as non-solicits for employees or different levels of non-compete agreements that can be helpful. But I think it depends what you're trying to cover with an NDA. An NDA can also keep confidential. I talked earlier about not worrying about sharing your idea. An NDA can ensure that some aspects of your business plan that you may never want to be out there are kept confidential. So if, especially if you're a growth stage business, you may know when your financials released into the marketplace and NDAs are already to that. Although I'd say depending on who they're for, they may not be necessary. As venture capitalists, we can't survive if we're going out and sharing other ideas. It just doesn't happen. And that might sound like a self-serving statement, but it's the reality of it, that we keep the information we have is confidential as a church mouse would.
Okay. And Bob, when do you know when your pitch is ready to bring to a potential investor?
When you feel that if you take a look at what I described as those 9 common mistakes, when you think you've answered those for yourself, I'd say you're ready. And if you're excited about that's time to come in. If you have the answers and you have the passion and the drive, and I can't emphasize that enough, that the passion and the drive are so important to a company because it will be a long road. The average time for a venture-backed business from funding to exit is 9 years. That's a long time. You're committing yourself to a big part of your life to get something launched. Now, the reality of it is that the companies that do well often do well a good amount of time before that, and it's a lot of companies that blend that in that struggle over time. But passion, drive, and you've answered those questions. And I hope, by the way, the connection is good. I did see a note from someone earlier saying that my voice might have been a little jumbled, so I hope you're all able to make this out okay over the line.
No, we can hear you perfectly now. It's been perfect the whole time. So we do have a few more questions. Do investors favor startup teams that have at least one previous founder?
It doesn't hurt. I guess someone that's been through it before is great because a second-time entrepreneur has been through it and they've seen the mistakes that will be made. And assuredly, it's okay to make mistakes. It always exists. As I said, every company will pivot. But it's by no means necessary. I would say of the companies that we back, this there's no science behind this number. I don't know, but two-thirds, maybe more, are first-time founders.
Okay. All right. And we have one alum on the line has a company called Hungry Globetrotter. It's a subscription box company for foodies. And he said, getting people, capital, and customers is the ultimate chicken and egg problem. Can equity crowdfunding be a way to hack that problem?
Maybe. Equity crowdfunding, I assume he's referring to under the new legislation that was passed by Congress that allows individuals to raise money through crowdsourcing. It might be a way to get it going. I would say that when a company's early life, I put that in that bucket of friends and family. It's generally very, very small investments from folks, and it's not a bad way to go.
Okay. And back to your number 3, repeatable customer acquisition strategy. Is this strategy typically tailored to the product or market vertical segment, or are there some repeatable customer acquisition strategies, approaches that you see work across most verticals and products?
It's a little bit of both. Some are very horizontal; they'll apply to any industry. Some are very vertical, that are deep within the company itself in terms of the way they might be. For instance, I have a company that's based in New York that's called Handybook, which is a relatively new investment. It's a couple of guys that dropped out of HBS, Harvard Business School, after their first year to start this company, and they provide services, in-home services, at this stage just in Boston, New York, and San Francisco, such as maid services and plumbers and electricians and the like, and it's all booked through an iPhone. But one of the ways they acquire customers is they work through building managers for very large apartment buildings in the city and have building managers distribute notice about their service to their tenants. Now, of course, there's a customer acquisition strategy that is very, very narrow that wouldn't apply to virtually any other business other than what they're doing. There are others that look at different types of viral growth that use a lot with word of mouth, use a lot with PR, which is a great horizontal one for customer acquisition strategy. Great public relations is by far the cheapest form of advertising you could ever hope to encounter, and there's one that's very horizontal across all industries.
Okay. And Bob, what are your top three favorite online resources to help entrepreneurs officially start their businesses?
Well, I have to be, I'll be parochial. I'd say I already gave them. They're all each of the, I would say it's follow Bob Davis at Bob Davis HCP on Twitter. there's my number one. I'm
about to
tweet
at you, Bob.
Yeah, there you go. But in terms of the resources, I would say, I don't know if I can give you a list of three that are great, but I would say most venture capitalists have, or many of the venture capitalists have, entrepreneurial sections of the websites that will give you some good ideas and good tips that I think that are would be real helpful in terms of where you're out there. I would say this isn't, the one I'm about to mention isn't an online resource, but what I would say, but it's a resource, I would say network, network, network. Meet other smart people that might be relevant in your category that can help you think and develop a year. And then, again, it goes with that. It's build that founding team early on. And I know that's not an online resource either, but build a founding team. It's rare. It almost never happens that we back one individual. We almost always back a founding team, which means there's a group of two or three domain experts that have come together with a great concept, and that's what we're looking to back. Sometimes a person comes in alone that's magical, but the premise that we believe in so strongly is that if you're going to build a company, you have to have this ability to recruit great talent, and we'd like to see some of that take place prior to the time something goes up. I know that's probably a weak answer to a good question, but unfortunately I don't have a great list of resources to point you to.
Well, Bob, I'm just going to ask you one last question. Everyone else, I'm sorry that we don't have time for this, but one last question. Are you ever aware of things people should watch out for when they're working with a lawyer? Are there any good resources you could maybe suggest for people to look to?
There's a lot of great law firms. I would say this is also, I sound a little like a broken record, but it's law firms relevant. There are firms, and there's many of them. I would know the ones in Boston and New York. I don't want to lay out any one in particular. But if someone reached out to me, I could point them in different directions. But there are folks that specialize in startups only. There are most good law firms will actually do early legal work for no cost around an idea you believe in. They will take the basic incorporation documents and they will help you get off the ground with the belief that if you do something, they will become your law firm, that you will be their law firm of choice. So most will do that if they believe in an entrepreneur. Now, they won't do that casually for anyone that shows up. They'd want to hear the same basic business pitch that I talked about that we would look for. But good law firms would do that. So I would say in whatever city you're in, ask around. Ask your friends and colleagues that have started companies and from them, find out who are the lawyers and the firms that they work with, and that's really the great, best way to go. Now, there are free legal, I shouldn't say free, there are do-it-yourself legal services that exist online. There's a company, a California-based company, venture-backed called LegalZoom, that will provide basic incorporation documents that you can buy and follow yourself, and it will take you through a step-by-step to do that. But I generally think great legal advice is very important for an entrepreneur. And as I said, some folks will do it for free, and when they won't, when you're at the stage, I think procuring that is a really important step in a company's growth.
All right. Well, and I do want to tell everyone we are going to be doing another webinar later on in the year on how a startup can protect themselves and a bit more about trademarking. And so that will focus on some more legal advice. But thank you so much for joining us today, Bob, especially while you're on vacation. Everyone go on and follow him on Twitter and make sure to tune in for more of our entrepreneurship webinar series. You all got the information before on our next webinar on April 2nd. And I thank you all for joining us.